So welcome.
Good to be here.
You know, I couldn't help but notice when we were in the back that along with the business suit, there's something on your sleeve.
Those are my malos.
Those are your malos. Yes.
And you depending on the situation at work, I may do japa mantra while I'm working, and okay. You know, keeps the stress down.
Okay, great. And have you always worn those, or was there a moment where you felt like, you know what, this is just an expression of something that seems important?
Well, I swapped these off for the scapular around my neck and the rosary in my pocket that I carried since I was age 8 at about 8-9 years ago when I broke my neck.
Oh, that's right. So I'd love to, some people might know that experience, but I'd love to, if you don't mind, starting from there in terms of that experience and how that might impact both your leadership but also your focus on some of the practices that have become important to you.
Yeah, I'll give you the thumbnail sketch. 2001, December 1st, my son was diagnosed with an incurable cancer, T-cell gamma delta lymphoma. And, you know, everybody always struggles with this issue of work-life balance. And the very first thing I did was I quit my work, and I was with him. And I engaged, and I found out that it wasn't my money or my power or my connections that could make a difference. It took my personal involvement in taking care of him that made a difference. And so we literally moved in together in a hospital room, spent better part of a year together as we did a mismatched bone marrow transplant, which is a bad outcome, graft versus host disease, to try and chase his cancer away. And I took care of him, fed him and bathed him and did all those sorts of things. And more importantly, ran the management process with the medical team every morning for an hour. What are today's priorities? What are we going to do? What's next? And if you ever get a chance to ask anyone at Boston Children's Hospital about Mark and his son, Mark, they, you know, you'll either see people light up with the experience because he wasn't supposed to live more than 6 months, and today he's now 28 years old and a productive member of society. The only one to ever survive his cancer. We put him in hospice twice, and his kidneys were damaged. I got two drugs approved for him, and his kidneys were damaged. And in 2007, in May, I donated my left kidney to him. And we get together on Sunday evenings. Actually, it was Saturday this week because Michigan was schooling Notre Dame in the game of football. And he sits on the right side so we can get the kidneys back together. I raised them on Bud, and he's drinking Natty Ice because it's 1997 for a 30-pack. But anyway, in between there, I broke my neck. And I was skiing with my daughter, and we were doing crazy things, and we were actually on the run out through the woods, and I checked over my shoulder because she had yelped, and I caught my left edge of my ski, and I hit a tree without ever seeing it. But luckily slid down into ice and snow and water and laid there for 2 hours while the team tried to rescue me, and that actually prevented my spinal cord from swelling, and it saved my life. And it happened on February 18th, 2004, which was exactly 1 year to the day Eric came home. And the reason that matters is in July 15th, 2002, we put Eric in hospice because he was not going to make it. And I was trained by Jesuits as a young boy, and Jesuits always suggest that you never make deals with God. You pray for the strength, the wisdom, and courage to make right decisions and to be right-minded. But on July 15th, and I did that. On July 15th, 2002, I went down to the chapel at the hospital after we put him in hospice, and I said, okay, me for him. I've lived a great life. Let me have his pain, and let him go on to be who he needs to be. And he got out and went home finally on February 18th, 2003, and 1 year to the day, I had my experience with a tree. And again, I proved, as many people do, that trees do not move, no matter how hard they are, particularly when they're well planted. So I broke five of my vertebrae, macerated my brachial plexus, subdural hematoma, coma for a week, last rites, woke up 7 days later in a hospital, and the very first question I asked was, how do I get out of here? Because I know you people will kill me.
And you'd worked in the health insurance industry.
Yeah, I worked in the health insurance industry. And it had nothing to do with the job I did. And they told me I needed to go up and down stairs in a walker, and 5 days later I signed out. Wow. And went home for rehabilitation and have been on that journey ever since. And so, you know, it all relates back to Eric because of this February 18th date, which is prominent in my mind, but also I'm spare parts.
Yeah.
But he can't have the other kidney till I'm done with it. So he's got to take care of what he's got.
Now,
but that really formed my thinking about how broken the system was, because it's really not a system.
Yeah.
His journey, I had to, you know, keep track of the food on his plate because he had allergies. I had to keep track of the lines going into his body, the medications they gave him. And I know about as much about bone marrow transplantation as any physician does. And then in my own journey, after I was done, people said, A, you shouldn't be alive, so consider yourself lucky. B, your pain is nothing we can deal with because it's a spinal cord injury that's creating the pain, not my arm. We can give you these pain medications and this letter for long-term disability, and given that you're an executive, you can get paid pretty well to stay home and get high.
legally.
And, you know, probably at the age of 22, I would have bought that deal all day long. But I couldn't, and I really needed to get back to work, and I needed to be productive, and I needed to do what I needed to do, something, you know, just sort of said. And so I don't take any pain medication.
Wow.
And the journey to find that was acupuncture, mm-hmm. cranial sacral therapy,
yeah.
which completely got me off all the drugs, and I get weekly. Yoga and meditation, which is how I control my pain.
Wow.
Now, that is not a cocktail that a physician will ever write on a prescription right. to say, here's what you need to do, go home and do this. And so since then, I've been on this sort of journey to try and build the evidence base
right.
to allow people to have access to the kind of capabilities that can make a difference, and have learned a lot of things along the way.
Yeah. Great. So I'm wondering, this might be a good segue to, in order to create the evidence base, you decided to start with Aetna.
Mm-hmm.
And do a couple of different programs. Do you want to speak briefly right. about kind of where that research has been? And we have a few. Michelle, do we have the clicker?
A couple of quick slides. So I've been attacked recently in the press and on the blogs, which is a common thing when you're an executive in any Fortune 100 company, but even more importantly when you're an executive in an insurance company, that we've sort of hijacked yoga and mindfulness for the bottom line of the corporation.
Okay, yeah.
And, you know, I think there was a good question in the discussion before about, you know, should you take care of people or should you make money?
Right.
And I would argue that the two are not an or, it's an and that they're inextricably linked.
Mm-hmm.
We define health, and there's a new program called Our Healthy from Aetna, which really starts to set these policy positions, because while the Affordable Care Act is a good step in the right direction to get people covered, it's not enough. It's necessary but not sufficient. We really need to redefine health as keeping people healthier so they're more productive. If they're more productive, they're more economically viable. If they're economically viable, they are happier.
Mm-hmm.
And when they're happier, particularly in groups, we have better communities, we have less uncivil dialogue among each other, and we develop and nurture children and grow our communities and make the planet a better place. And so if you take that as a definition of health, the system that we have today is not structured properly.
Yeah.
The biggest driver of healthcare costs in Aetna, we have found, is that people in the top quintile of stress spend more than $2,000 of healthcare more a year.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, how can we address that? Twice a year, I go to the Hanuman Temple in Watsonville, California, up on Mount Madonna.
Oh, yeah.
And do, you know, yoga, Vedic chanting and Sanskrit study, and eat a lot of vegan food and detox from caffeine and Budweiser beer. And one of the people that I do that with is Gary Krafsow, who runs the American Vinyoga Institute. So with Gary and his team, and the e-mindfulness people, we developed a program, a 12-week program for our employees on a pilot. And we actually asked for volunteers on both coasts. We got 729 people. We found that people on the West Coast were actually much more stressed than people on the East Coast, which I found stunning. I think the definition of stress and what triggers stress in people on the West Coast is probably a little different than the East Coast, right? And I won't make any pejorative comments about that, but... and what we found is that when we put these people through this program, we saw stress levels reduced by 36%. And all, again, toward building these communities inside our organization that take care of the people that we serve. I don't take care of our members. Our employees do. They create the sustainability of our product by the value of the empathy and the value and compassion and service that they provide to our members. Caring is one of our core corporate values. And that is driven by empathy and the ability to take care of people, understanding how people are feeling on the other end of the phone.
Right.
So if we go to the next slide. So what we did is we've seen a dollar return, of 11 to 1 on our investment, 69 minutes per week of productivity. Now, why does all that matter? It doesn't matter to me. We actually saved a couple of our employees' lives through this program, and just saving one of them was worth every penny we spent putting this program together. But this is what the corporate people and the AMA people need in order to justify the evidence base. So I'm sharing with you the evidence base, because when we have evidence base, we can actually cover this stuff.
Right.
Now, we can't do a double-blind study. But we can actually show people that there's a return on investment in the analysis. We also have healthy lifestyle coaching. So we focus on treating the person, not the condition. And so we've seen a 53% increase in choosing lower fat diets, 51% reported better ability to deal with stress, and 54% lost weight. And one of the people that lost weight was over 400 pounds, and she was going to kill herself. But through this program and through yoga, she is now still with us and living a vibrant and productive life. So all of this just keeps, and these are the notes we got. And so we actually ask people to do pre and post evaluations. And you can see here, you know, it's empowering to know that I have a choice and I can only, only I can control the quality of my life and well-being. I have a little card on my desk that says, I shall let no one decide my day, and have made that my mantra. So, and this is another one, I don't feel lost anymore. I have found myself and have direction and purpose. And there are just tons of these notes that we get from our employees as an investment. 6,000 of our employees have gone through the program already. We now offer it to all of our clients who are now offering it. And we've had over, we're now approaching 6 million people having access to these programs, should they choose to do it.
Wow, and it's all covered.
It depends on the employer, but but we cover it completely. We don't charge anything for it.
Well, that's great. So I've got numerous questions that I know people do here. So how do you begin to present this to your board? Because my guess is you have some ability to do things, but there's also a certain limits, and there's a way in which you need other partners to be to say yes to this. And while the evidence approach, I'm sure, has some leeway, have you found skillful ways to present it to people where they you feel like they become partners versus like, what, Mark and his yoga thing? Like, all right, we'll just let him do a little bit, but like, you know, behind the scenes, they're just
that was the initial response
like,
to the yoga. People said, okay, the chairman does yoga, so now we all have to do yoga,
really? Right.
I think the evidence base proved it out. But our chief medical officer was actually the most recalcitrant in accepting it at first because it doesn't fit within the traditional medical model. But once he saw the results, he was like, wow, this is amazing. Of course, he's upset that I use a naturopath as well. But but I think the issue with the board and probably the most important thing is, first of all, they selected me to run the company, and they knew who I was.
Right.
So, you know, there's a difference there. I mean, not too many people with my pedigree and past. You know, in 1979, I was putting together rear axles on the Mercury Bobcat assembly line and went back to school so I could become a union steward. So I'm not the typical CEO. When people attack me for the job I have and for the role I have without knowing who I am, I always remind them, maybe every once in a while, one of us sneaks in to get control where we can make a difference.
Right.
and so the board has... the board looks at one thing, are the shareholders happy?
Right.
And are we providing a valuable product? And the two are very connected. So back to the point of making a profit.
Yeah.
Every organization, whether it is for-profit or not-for-profit, whether it is in commercial or it is in charitable activity, needs to generate a margin to keep the mission going.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, the Daughters of Charity have a saying, most profitable healthcare system in America. It's now called the Ascension Health System, or most profitable healthcare system in the world. No margin, no mission. So you can't continue the mission unless you can continue to invest in the business. We do not take our profits at Aetna and give them to our shareholders. Our shareholders trade in the stock of the company.
Right.
And that stock price moves based on our earnings, which have been fairly consistent in their pattern for the last 6 years. But more importantly, it's the price earnings multiple that defines the stock price. Buy the stock low, sell it high. That PE moves on the basis of whether or not we develop a sustainable, valuable product to the people we serve. And the moment they don't think that's going to happen, that price earnings multiple falls, which is what happened in 2008 as the president came into office and the Affordable Care Act, because we don't know if these guys are going to be in business anymore. But now they've come back. It's that PE, which is driven not by me, I'm the messenger, it's by the employees in the organization creating that sustainable product. And unless I invest in them and making them better people and happier, I can't create a sustainable product in the marketplace.
Right.
So it's not about making money. So as long as that's all happening, the board is happy.
Right. You know, they it's not about
I
making
ride my motorcycles or get back on and I'm on my skis again. They prefer I don't do either of those things, but it's the employees that sustain the enterprise.
Right. But it's not about making money, but there's a connection that you see around engaging with your employees, taking care of your employees, and the results that, the company gets.
I've had a blog for 6 years. I communicate every day on it with my employees directly. Right. It's evangelism. And then I have the apostrophe, which is I talk to my team, and they talk to their team, and they talk to their team. And I check the two by virtue of what I'm hearing from the employees in the blog. Every site visit I do, and I do them continually wherever I go to every cubicle, shake every employee's hands personally, and thank them for the work they do. And the stories I hear about what they do for our customers is what I share with the full employees when I do all the employee meetings. So that connection with the employees, I'm being real approachable and you know and listening to them is really powerful.
And do you see as some of the roadblocks for some of these practices that we seem evidence-based, it seems to suggest that this is a much better way to do healthcare, or at least adding this in is a much better way to do healthcare. And I'm sure there's an audience here and a larger audience that would just love to be able to have affordable practices that they can do beyond waiting until they get sick and then going to a hospital.
Well, the great thing about this is it's pretty cheap. Working on yourself. And you don't have to pay yourself to do it. You just need a little training to do it. And, you know, every day I get up at 5:30 to do my practice because I know I'm headed into a chaotic world where I'm going to hear a lot of good and bad things, and I'm going to be challenged about my own worth. And unless I can bring myself to that environment in a steady and mindful way and to be present in the moment every opportunity I can't help the people around me and lead them. And so I think that for every leader in this room, if you don't have that practice, I can pretty much guarantee you that for the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to be in a very difficult economy, a very difficult cultural evolution, and we won't know just how powerful these moments are ever since 2007, 2008, until we're well past it. And we'll look back and go, that was a major shift. And I think people are ready for a different brand of leadership and a different kind of heart in the work we do every day.
It's going to pause. And how do, as you've become more of a spokesperson for this, what has been the response from other CEOs or other leaders? Have they, I'm sure there's been varied, but what kind of reception are you getting within the larger community?
There's a lot more receptivity to the message now than there ever has been because they're feeling the same pain and stress that everybody else is. It's not a great time to be a CEO of any corporation. If you know you need affirmation from the external world, and you know, I think you know, there's a group at Harvard we've been working with called Higher Ambition Leadership. Started with a small group of us, it's now growing every year. About how we as corporations in the communities where we live, work, and play can do good and do well.
Yeah,
and how we can give back. And I think if we do that and we build healthier communities, we can't help but continue to be successful.
Yeah. And how do you respond to the people who say, you know what, doing all this is nice. I don't have the time. You know, like getting up early in the morning. Yeah, if I was in a lot of pain, I might do it. Right. You know, I can get a lot of shit done. And I can't just spend an hour not getting shit done. So, what's, you know, it just doesn't make a lot of sense.
There's no better shit to get done than working on your own shit. I got it. So, yeah. Just saying.
But I, very tweetable.
You know, I think a great... You know, because of the environment I'm in and the way I work, I look at my calendar all the time. So, right. You know, I have a constant calendar review going on. But I would argue that, you know, 10 years ago, what I did is I sat down, if you track your time just for 2 weeks and you look and you actually keep track of what you are doing, you'll notice all sorts of parts of time during your day where you're wasting your time.
Yeah.
And if you could put that together in one place, and for me, that was 5:30 in the morning, every morning, where I know, and the team around me knows, you're not going to get a hold of me, I'm not going to respond, you know, I'm going to be doing my thing. That, you know, if you can put that together in one place, you can get it done.
Right.
And it's, and if you sleep better, and if you're more effective at work, and you're more mindful, and you're present, the meetings are shorter, the rework is gone, the people around you appreciate your leadership, and you have a better you have a better life. It's so simple if you would just do it. And that's, you know, and I think that's the thing that people have to commit to is just doing it, working on themselves.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I mean, from my belief system, it's all in here anyway, right? Yeah. This is all illusion, right? You, me, the duality, it's all part of the journey, finding back to the one realization that we're all the same thing.
You know how odd that is coming from somebody in your position. I just want you to know. It's great. Yeah, every once in a while, some people sneak through.
But you can do you can tie it to something. Let's take diversity, right? Okay. So, if we were to bring your friends up here on the stage, and we were to line up, do they all look just like you, dress like you, have the same interests as you, got the beard thing going? No, the jeans. Is everybody the same? Would you want them all to be the same?
No.
Right? So we have this group of people that we surround ourselves who are incredibly different and bring different life experiences that excite us. We want to be with them.
Yeah.
Right? But yet, in this room, everybody is 99.5% biologically the same. Mm-hmm. We're 95% biologically the same with a pig. Mm-hmm. At the very basic level. Yet we let that 0.5%, and in the case of pigs, that 5%, get in the way of learning whether or not that person is somebody we want to have in our life because of the experiences and everything they bring.
Yeah.
So that's that one.
Yeah.
And that's the journey.
Yeah.
Is being able to look past that, realizing we're all the same thing, and that it's that diversity, that duality that creates the excitement of the journey.
Excellent. And what would you say are some of the defining characteristics of that hour and a half of practice time where one discovers that? I mean, because some people are like, oh, I go for a walk or, you know, I search the internet and I get interesting information. Right. But it seems like there's certain elements that fall into whether somebody's actually in a kind of a deep, more of a spiritual place or whether they're just kind of in the normal mode.
Well, you know, I read this one thing about Sting one time because, you know, he's infamous for his tantric practices and how, you know, he has these 6 hours of, you know, this relationship going, right? And... And he had this, and you know, we're all going, wow! I wish I could do that. And I saw an interview from him at one point that said the 6 hours is actually I called during the middle of the afternoon while I was working and talked to my wife, and we engaged in a conversation. And I was heartfelt in my approach to her about how she was doing that day, and we went and had dinner and we had a lovely conversation about what we were going to do the next week, and then we went to a movie and then we got home, and the real part was a heck of a lot shorter than 6 hours. But it was that whole 6 hours that was the event.
Yeah.
And so it depends on what you need.
Yeah.
So when I get up in the morning, I have my asana, and then I have my pranayama, and then I have my Vedic chanting, and I have my meditation. And I, the one that I always get a kick out of is, you know, asana, pranayama, and chanting are ways of stilling the mind and the body so you can sit in meditation and search internally for an extended period of time. Go on that journey. And people say, well, how do you block out everything for that long in meditation? And meditation's not about blocking out all that stuff.
Right.
Meditation is about taking what comes, giving it appropriate reverence, and learning to let it go, to lose attachment to it. Mm-hmm. And so that's the practice. And so it may depend on what your day is. You may be going into work for a very stressful situation. That's going to come into your head. Give it what it's due and let it go.
Yeah.
And so it can change. It can be a walk. I was just up in the, you know, as you saw on my Twitter account, I was up in the on the glaciers in Banff. And, you know, wow, what a, I mean, I was at the source of water.
Yeah.
You know, with, you know, with Mari and the dog. And we're sitting there going, this is where it comes from, right here. This is a holy place.
Right.
This is as pure as it gets right here.
Right.
So,
have you seen the phrase, everybody should meditate for 15 minutes? Unless you're really busy, then you should meditate for an hour. But I do think people need...
As Mark Twain said, I would have written a shorter letter had I had the time.
Yeah. Yeah. But it, it does seem that there are certain characteristics to actually what makes that time enriching and rewarding. And so it could be yoga for somebody. It could be something else for somebody else.
It can be the space wherever you can find yourself.
Yeah.
You know, and I have my meditation, my yoga room with my, you know, Tibetan singing bowls and all that other stuff. But sometimes that's not the right place.
Yeah.
Someday I want to be walking in Elizabeth Park in Hartford with the dog.
Yeah.
Watching the sun come up.
Yeah. And do you find it overlap or it's overflowing into the rest of your life?
Yes.
The time that you...
Most definitely. So I have intractable neuropathic pain. Mm-hmm. So my left arm feels like it's on fire all day long. It never stops. Yeah. This minute right now, it feels like it's on fire. And the only way to control it is to control my sympathetic nervous system.
Wow.
Which means most people think I'm being zen because I'm really cool. No, it hurts when I'm not.
Wow. There's that immediate...
Well, there's a balance between the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. Yeah. That's what, you know, helps manage your pain. And because of my spinal cord injury, I can't do that.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I have this pain all the time. So this, you know, keeping your sympathetic nervous system under control is a great way to manage your pain. You have to have a practice to do it. So it spills into the whole rest of my life.
Wow. And you don't take any you find that you can do it without medications?
Yes, except for every once in a while, a Macallan 18 or a Budweiser. That is a form of medication.
I think that's in the Vedas somewhere.
Is it?
Yeah, there is that mention. It's in the footnote.
In the Vedas?
It's in there, yeah. Yeah, they recommend.
Was that between Arjuna and Krishna?
So I want to open up for some questions in a bit, but I'm wondering, there's a lot of people here who would love to support you.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, what's your wish? Is there something that this larger community could do that kind of moves forward some of these efforts, not just at Aetna, but within the larger world?
So I had this conversation at the NACD one time, the National Association of Corporate Directors. So you have to know your audience, right? Mm-hmm. So I couldn't have this same kind of conversation. This is an audience that gets it, so it's a lot easier.
Yeah.
So you have to know your audience. And there are a lot of times I bring you know, principles of yoga into the workplace, but I don't highlight them as principles of yoga.
Right. They're just principles.
Right? You know, I don't say, you know, this is, you know, ahimsa. You know, it's, you know, we're going to be very present today. Mm-hmm. And so I want all the machines off. Mm-hmm. And if you need to go use them, then, you know, we don't need you here. Because this is a moment where we're going to be focused.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to be with each other and present for each other in order to get to the right place.
Mm.
That's, you know, you know, being present in the moment. Now, most people, you know, don't have to associate it with yoga or the yoga tradition. But they get what the message is.
Yeah.
And so I think you have to know your audience and you have to introduce these ideas in ways that's receptive to the people who are hearing them. Let them practice them.
Mm-hmm.
And as they go along, light bulbs go off.
Right.
As I did in my own yoga journey.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Which was, you know, geez, I'm doing this asana initially because I thought it was good practice because I couldn't run anymore after my neck injury. And I said, but there's something more to this. And I began the journey. And now, you know, the asana is just a small part of what I do every day.
Right. But it came from the pain, or it came from the accident.
It came from the accident.
But if somebody had introduced that before the accident, would you have?
I would have said yoga's for chicks.
Right.
Sorry. That's what I would have said.
Yeah.
I don't say that anymore.
Right.
That's what I would have said.
Yeah. But that people are often pushed there either through stress or through pain or through... There's some experience often that...
They begin a journey, and if they're with the right people, and often we're put together with people that help us make that journey,
yeah.
Right? We're put together for a reason, and if you are open to the individual, you'll find that way. You'll be helped along the way.
Right. So if you have a question, you can step up to the mic. I don't know if we'll have time for everybody, but we'll have time for a few. So if you want to step up to the mic.
So, Mark, first I would like to say thank you. I'm feeling very blessed to have heard your story and also very grateful, just filled with this deep sense of gratitude to know that there are other executives like you out there. So thank you for that. One thing that struck me during your speech was how steadfast you are in your beliefs. And I'm wondering if you could share whether it was adversity or either external criticism, which you mentioned you're kind of in the midst of today. What factors you feel have ever shaken that, and how did you overcome it?
Well, you know, I think I've always been a person that's had a center, something to hold on to. I think... And I've also been a person that has been reinvented a number of times based on my own journey. And so the opportunity is to understand when it's time and to know where you need to move. And that takes a level of curiosity and courage that allows you to do that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was, you know, very, very, very devout Catholic. You know, raised in a Catholic home, very involved in the church, part of the Christian family movement, preparing for when priests wouldn't be around. And, you know, I had to rethink that in 2002 and 2003, even before my accident, mm-hmm. as part of my journey with my son, and said, what more do I need to understand here? Mm-hmm. And so you have to be open. I mean, I would have never imagined being where I am. Mm-hmm. But here I am. And so it's the curiosity and the courage to take those steps. Mm-hmm. And I've always been a person that's looked in the dark corners and never been afraid of the dark. And I think, you know, if you have that courage to look in those places where you don't think it's appropriate, you know, I think you can learn a lot about yourself and where you should be and what your role is.
You're from Detroit.
Born and raised.
Which has to help with my guess is that, I mean...
I can't be intimidated or insulted.
They tell me that about Detroit people. My guess is you get it from both sides. You get it from the healthcare industry who probably criticize you for trying to change a system that they feel like is working. Mm-hmm. And you probably get it from the other people, whether it's hardcore yogis who think this should not be brought into...
The corporate world.
And yeah. It's going to dilute it and it's going to make it all yucky and bad.
I'm all about making money and therefore yoga to make money.
Right. Yeah, that's quite sure how that works. But and what is your response? Do you feel like there is some danger if all of a sudden now there's thousands of yoga classes being taught across the world that insurance is covering?
You save one life. It was well worth it.
Yeah.
And so I think if we can do more of that and the employees of our company, you know, they should have a living wage. They should have, you know, quality of life, and we shouldn't make their work destroy them. They're not tools of capitalism. They really are an important part of our commitment to the people we serve. And if we do that right and make that investment in them, we're going to get it back tenfold.
Yeah, great.
Mark, thank you very much. What is it that gives you the courage to keep following your own inner voices and your own truth and to do exactly what it is that you think is the right thing to do and that you continue, obviously, to do?
You know, part of it is I'm not going to die from it. And when you stare at death enough, and I used to work in the Cass Corridor in downtown Detroit and, you know, dealt with a lot with death. I've seen a lot of people die. When I had to watch my son and then when I had my own experience, you know, the real cool thing is that this isn't going to kill me. Mm-hmm. And that if I actually approach it properly, it's actually, you know, the stress. I don't have stress in my life, believe it or not.
Great. This is just a very brief anecdote that I think you'll relate to. In 1991, my wife was told that she had 3 months to live stage four breast cancer. And 7 years later, when they were doing rounds at Sloan Kettering, her oncologist said, "How'd you do it? How'd you beat the profile?" And she said, "Budweiser."
Yeah. It's good stuff.
Oh, one this way.
Hi.
Thank you. Hi. So I'm wondering, I don't know if you'll be joining us for dinner, and so I'm wondering how you would answer the question about what the barriers are for businesses adopting this or integrating it into their culture, meditation, yoga, what some of those barriers are and what some of your ideas are about how we might move beyond those barriers.
I think much like we view health care as a cost of doing business, businesses for a long time have viewed employees as a cost of doing business instead of an integral part of what it is they offer to the people they serve. And I think, you know, I think there is a shift, and I think the world is going to demand that corporations have missions and are mission driven. Profit is not a goal. Profit is the output of a mission driven organization that delivers a consistent product to their customers. And you can't do that without good employees and investing in them. And we can't have vibrant societies within which to run our corporations if we have people who are not making a living wage and can't afford the products and services we offer. And we can't continue to evolve as mankind unless we create better people and help them be better people. Because, you know, if you look around you, the lack of civility and the nature of the dialogue in today's society, you know, I would lock my children up in their rooms for the kind of way people treat each other today in the public domain. And I just think it's intolerable, and we're sending very bad examples to the next generation on how to get things done. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, I think we have an obligation. We have lost our heroes, and we have lost the people we can look up to on how to behave and how to be better societies. And I think somebody has to do it. And guess what? I've been given the opportunity to, you know, run a $50 billion company with a lot of employees, and if I can just make that difference and we can start to move ahead with some other corporations who are doing the very same thing, maybe we can reestablish some civility and move further as a race.
Can I ask you the question, what percentage of middle management at Aetna messages the way you do?
Good question. And, you know, and it's going to take a while, but we do build momentum over time. And so I, you know, again, my blog, my Twitter, my communications to employees, when you've said it so many times you can throw up, you're about halfway there. And so you just have to keep at it, and more importantly, you have to live it. And so we have to, you know, we make some really tough decisions inside our company every day. And when we have to lay off people, which we've had to do in years past, that's a failure of leadership. That's not the failure of them. And we make that known, and we deal with it. And so I think, you know, we have to live that life. And it's not universally held across the corporation. And I've got people inside the company and middle management who don't want that. And we've begun the dialogue over the last year now, where at our last all hands-on-deck meeting, I said to folks, if you can't sign on, and I know I have an obligation to communicate and help convince you, if you can't sign on, you need to leave.
Sign
because
on
we don't
to,
want you here.
Sign on to?
To the mission and to the way we're going to work together. So in my management team, across every management level of management, you are rewarded 50% on your scorecard. Did you hit your numbers? And the other 50% is, did you behave properly in doing it as a leader? Mm. So you cannot get to be a jerk and get paid. Being told to stop, but we're ready. We're getting the stop sign.
We're getting the stop sign. We can override
that. I'm good.
That.
Okay, good. Are you like in charge?
We have the power.
Are you in charge?
Yeah.
That's good. I'm with this guy, sorry.
We can override it to a certain extent. But.
Thank you for all you've shared. And I'm finding myself wondering what the conversation might sound like between Mark now and the Mark who might have said yoga is for chicks.
Yeah. It was, you know, and I actually had that conversation with the Marks who are coming up in the organization. So. I do. And I say to them, you know, I don't want you to go through the experiences I went through to learn what I have learned. And I think I'm in some ways uniquely prepared to be in this role at this time. Wouldn't have picked this to be the time to be a CEO in America, but I'm uniquely prepared to do it. And I would tell that, Mark, that, you know, you may be the smartest guy in the room and you may have a point of view, but unless you engage the collective people around you and learn from them, you are not going to be successful. And you know, I had to have it knocked into me, and I share it with people all the time. So I have a lot of informal mentees in the company I spend a lot of time with, and we talk about that journey and what I would have done differently had I had the chance. But I would not change one step of my journey given where I am today, in spite of how difficult it's been. Yes.
Thanks for staying with us a few more minutes. I was just wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about the other 100 CEOs. You know, who are you inspired by? Do you feel less lonely in the journey today because more are coming on? I'm sure there are many CEOs that we'd love you all to meet in, you know, on the planet, in America, et cetera. We're very happy this is being taped. But, you know, other CEOs out there, other leaders, are you feeling more momentum?
Yeah, I am, actually. And, you know, I think the more that I'm open about it, and, you know, this is not the first time I've been open about it, the more I get feedback from them about how are you doing that? And can I join you? And is there a way I can get involved? You know, I'm one of the founders of Fix the Debt in Washington. You know, we brought together a bunch of CEOs, not for the reasons that we were attacked by both sides of the aisle for, but really that we can't get the economy moving forward and we can't put people back to work unless we are responsible longer term. Not tomorrow. It's not about cutting programs tomorrow. It's about putting a plan in place over the next 10 to 15 years that shows us where the glide path is. Restore confidence and we can get the economy going much faster than it is. And so it was an attempt to put pressure. And that kind of dialogue among CEOs is happening more and more. What can we do to work together? What can we learn from each other? The Higher Ambition Leadership Program at Harvard is about sharing. How do you talk to your board about this stuff without getting fired? What do your employees think when you walk down the hall and you never wear a tie anymore and you have a little, you know, necklace around your neck? What do you know, do they listen to you anymore? You know, all those sorts of things. You have to have the suit on every time. You know, if I'd known the kid, I would have had my jeans on there.
Right,
I
mean, you know,
I saw business casual. Is it business casual?
I don't know. Well, see, we do a wisdom in business, so we get emails saying, "What do I wear?" Because it's business, it's New York, but then it's also wisdom, and it's Google. It's at Google, so people are really confused. It's a very confused dress. Yeah.
Yeah.
So what I generally tell people is come how they're comfortable, which brings it back to them.
So I think more and more people are listening to it, and they're more interested in the dialogue. Maybe not some as brave to step forward, but more and more people are trying it. Mm-hmm.
Maybe one more and we'll call it a day.
So I'm interested. Can you hear me? I'm really sure.
Yes.
Okay. I'm interested if you look even 3 to 5 years out, what role you see technology playing in its ability to engage people and maybe more proactive mental well-being.
So I like technology a lot. I think it has its place, and we need to understand its role. And my partner, you know, she has weaned me off of, you know, every time the thing buzzes, I don't need to pick it up and see what was on there. And we have this dialogue. She, you know, she and her friends And they're the little yogi community.
She's a yogi.
They got iPhones, and I said, that's it. We're done. Apple's done. They got iPhones finally. And I think this whole connection with technology can do a number of things. It creates social networks that people have. I have communities of people I interact with who know me for who I am much better than if I ever tried to do it on television or in the written form. And so at our company, I'm pushing really hard to blow up the email system over the next 3 years and go totally social media. And we engaged all, we have now a Blava inside and Java and all these other things we're using inside our Jive inside our corporation to introduce social media and working together, because you can get people together real time. You can solve problems immediately instead of the, I called so-and-so and I haven't heard back, or I sent them an email, which is one of 200 in their email box. Mm-hmm. So my inbox on my email has 4,985 emails in it. And the corporation in 3 years has not collapsed because I didn't read every one of them. You know, and so I think there's an opportunity to use technology in meaningful ways. I think the technology in healthcare is going to dramatically reshape how we take care of each other. Mm-hmm. And so we're developing products and services that will allow people to stay home. We'll be able to check for arterial impedance in the heart before the heart starts to create a collection of water weight, which then leads to a congestive heart failure event. And so all of that technology is going to allow us to live healthier lives and for us to interact with each other on a real-time basis to stay healthy and manage my health versus trying to navigate a healthcare system that's labyrinthian and disconnected. So I think technology's got its place, but we do need to have this journey that looks inside, not at, you know, this thing all the time. We need to look inside, and this isn't going to help you with that. Mm-hmm. It'll give you support from your community, but it won't help you.
Yeah. Okay. And how I actually first, I'd read an article about you, and so I immediately went to Twitter.
Yes.
And I tweeted to you, and you responded. And that, otherwise, I would have never made it. I'm not encouraging people to do that, because you probably can't respond to everybody.
As long as you're nice.
Okay.
Twitter's about listening, by the way. So.
It's true. Yeah, it's true. And then we started the back and forth that led to you appearing here today.
Well, it's great to be here, so thank you so much for inviting me.
So thank you, Mark. It's really
thank
beautiful.
You.